Okay, hello everyone. My name is Ignacio Burgueño. I'm a software developer from Uruguay. I've been writing software for 14 years and specifically using Lua since 12, since Lua 4.01 came out. And today I'd like to tell you about the 7th Spectrum emulator I wrote in Lua 5.3, how easy it was due to the ability to generate code on the fly, to parse binary data, and using the new bitwise operators. But first, a little bit of history. So at the end of the 70s, beginning of the 80s, computers entered the home and schools of many people, since a lot of affordable models hit the market. Maybe some of you recognize some of these models. The ZX Spectrum was one of the most popular. It's the one at the left, most popular in Britain in the 80s, like Commodore 64 and the Apple II were the US. The BBC Model B, it was used in schools in Britain as part of the computer literacy project. The Thomson MO5 and Yorick were popular in France, I think. And the MSX, which was actually a standard, so many manufacturers sold compatible models like Philips and Sony. And these machines were popular in Japan, Argentina, and Brazil, too, I think. It was in 1986, a friend taught me into taking a course on computers, and this was the first language I learned. I'm giving away my age. But the second language I learned was BASIC, Sinclair BASIC, in fact, with line numbers and all of that. So, but I didn't know what I was ruining my career. And this was the computer I used, the TK90X, a Brazilian clone of the ZX Spectrum. Just a quick note, in those years in Brazil there was a law called Reserva de Mercado, a market reserve, that law forbade the import of computer equipment to protect national industry. So it was really common to see clones of different computers. This machine was built by a company called MicroDigital in Sao Paulo, and it hit the market in 1996, and was basically a Spectrum whose operating system had been translated to Portuguese and also to Spanish, plus some additions. So, in 1998, my parents bought me one of those computers. They had no monitor, so you had to plug them on your TV. Once you turn them on, it would straight into a BASIC interpreter. So then you could start to program or just load games, which everyone, the most common activity. From cassette tapes. So the machine was really simple but powerful. It had 16 kilobytes of ROM that stored the BASIC interpreter. You had 48 kilobytes of RAM, 16 colors. Games were made with only that. One channel sound, and a SEC80 CPU, which was very popular in those days. Arcade machines like Pac-Man had one of those CPUs. Most of the software for this machine was built made by British and Spanish companies, but other countries left their mark to this game. Some of the Swedes here may know it. It's called Fairlight, and was written by a Swedish programmer called Bo Jangevo in 1995. And it was quite a revolutionary game for its time, the 3D isometric graphics. But I actually think that the Commodore 64 was more popular here in Sweden. So, many years later, I got a PC. I found out that there were programs called emulators that allow Spectrum software to run on the PC. So I bought a couple of books and set off to write an emulator myself. It's one running down there. It turned out to be a hideous mix of C as well as assembler. But it was a fun experience, and I learned a lot in the process. So, this January, when Lua 5.3 came out, I saw the Bitwise operators and said, well, why not rewriting the emulator in Lua? Because, after all, it's not at hand. So, all that we need to do is to replace circuits with software. And so, to replace the CPU, we will write an interpreter, just like Lua itself. So, let's take a look at the architecture of the Spectrum. Here we have the PCB board. We can see the CPU. This is a custom made chip that generates the video display. RAM here, and TV output. That thing up there. So, keeping things simple, this is the architecture of a Spectrum. You have the CPU, a Xeon Z80, driven by a clock at 3.5 MHz. You have 16 kilobytes of ROM, which holds the base interpreter and other stuff. 16 kilobytes of RAM that is used as video RAM. The rest is of RAM. But that's pretty much it. It interfaces with the keyboard, tape, input and output, and the speaker. So, let's start drafting some code to and getting things out of the way. We have the memory. The Spectrum has 64 kilobytes of memory. And that's the most it can address without resorting to hardware tricks. That's because the CPU is an 8-bit CPU, but it has an address bus of 16 bits. So we can use a table as an array to emulate the RAM and a couple of functions to read and write into the memory. When writing, we discard write to the RAM and we throw an error if the address we are trying to write or read is out of the range. So this is the architecture of the Z80 CPU. You have many 16-bit registers, this one, and these other registers are also 16-bit, but can be accessed as individual 8-bit ones. For instance, this register PC can be accessed the high byte as register B and the low byte as register C. Also, some of the registers have an alternate. For instance, HL has an alternate register called HL prime that cannot be accessed individually. Instead, you have to swap like a bank. So, we use a table to store the registers. There's also this field, these states, we'll talk about later. But basically, you have all registers as a fields in a table, plus the memory access functions. So now we have a basic representation of the CPU, but we are still lacking an important part, the instruction set. So the CPU has many instructions divided into families. To load data from memory into registers, to perform additions, subtractions, logical operations, AND, OR, XOR, incrementing, decrementing registers. So instructions in the SetID are represented as byte sequences. Most of them a concept of an operation code, also called an opcode, and some immediate data. For instance, this instruction load A42 loads the value 42 into the register A, and that's the byte sequence it corresponds. So during normal operation, the processor will fetch the instruction point by the PC register, decode it, fetch additional data, execute it, and then adjust the value of PC to point at the next instruction. So the CPU will do that over and over again until reset or switch off. But after a certain time, the processor has to service interrupts. So many times a second, the processor takes a detour, does a small shot on the side, and then goes back to its regular channel. And here appears those these states we mentioned before. And so these states correspond to clock cycles. Each instruction takes a certain amount of these states to fully execute, and it can be anywhere from 4 to 23, it states the longest. And in the spectrum, an interrupt happens every roughly 70,000 t-states. Yeah. So, we can write a function that takes a machine and runs forever, reading instructions, incrementing the PC register, and executing the instruction. And when it completes a frame, it handles the interrupts. But how do we know what to do on each instruction? Each instruction is implemented as a function. No? So for instance, the instruction load A that I mentioned before is implemented like that. We read a byte from memory and store it in register A. After doing that, this is a tricky part, since all registers are 16-bit. When we increment or decrement it, we have to clip the address because we can overflow that value. So we perform a NAND with the maximum value that can be represented in 16 bits. So there are many instructions that share a certain amount of functionality. For instance, the rotate left family of instructions. There are many instructions that rotate left each register. So it seems a lot of work to write one function for each opcode. Here I decided to abstract the generation of the instructions using templates. And this is the template I use to generate the logical, all 8-bit logical operations. Take left, right, shift left, shift right, and so on. Just by using string format, on that string, I can start building every instruction. Here, this is what the template looks like after substitution. We're building the rotate left family. These are quite short, but other instructions take more boilerplate code, so they, in those particular cases, the benefits are more clear. So once we have this, I use load to compile and produce a chunk, which we then call and store it in our opcodes table. That's pretty much it. Okay. This is the source, I compile, I call it, supply the function that performs the actual operation, and store it in a table. Okay, until now we're working in the dark. We need to emulate the video generator to see what's going on. So the screen is generated by this custom chip called the ULA. For years it was much of a mystery how it worked, and thanks to many people, and now by means of reverse engineering it, now we have a thorough description of its inner workings. So the ULA reads data from RAM to build a picture, which is 256 pixels wide and 192 pixels tall, plus an area around on the border. So to avoid consuming too much RAM, there are certain restrictions on the number of colors. The screen is divided into eight pixels wide squares. So in each of those cells, there can be only two colors at the same time. So we have 24 rows and 32 columns, with only two colors in it at the same time. Okay, so since both the ULA and the CPU needs to access the RAM, there is some contention. So sometimes the ULA takes priority. So from time to time, the ULA needs to stop the CPU, making it work slower. So the arrayment instruction can take from a variable number of clock cycles. And that was commonly used to do some color effects. Here there is more than two colors per individual cell, just by timing when to execute each instruction and timing with the TV scan lines. So I'm using Lua SDL2 to do the drawing. This is currently the slowest part of the emulator, but because my lack of experience with the library, I'm drawing pixel by pixel, and that's the slowest way there is to do the writing. So, loading games into the emulator, we need to deal with binary data. Many other Spectrum emulators have established standard formats to describe, to preserve the software. And a huge number of games and utilities have been preserved using these formats. This, for instance, is called SNAP, which stands for snapshot. And this is the description. It has, it stores the data of each register, the state of intervals, the call of the board, and then a dump of the RAM memory. So, using string unpack, parsing this file format was really easy. It's just a one-liner. But we read the whole snapshot, unpack it, set the resistance, and we are good to go. But I would prefer that code to be more clear. I don't know this thing where it is going. So I could line the variables with the string that it corresponds, but I wanted to put both things in the string, the format string. What I'm reading and where I'm assigning. So this is what I would like to read. So it's quite clear that I'm first reading a byte and storing it into local I, then reading a word and storing it into local HLP. And so, but lucky for me, it was a 5 minute job to do that. I just needed two things, to parse the string, to extract the data relevant to string unpack, which is that data, and the name of the local variable where it is going to be stored. So with that information, I can reassemble the form of string, call unpack, collect the values, and assign the local variables. And that's the code. We have two functions. One that retrieves the local variables of a given function, will be given the name of the variable and its index, so we store both information into a table. And then the format string, the new format string is parsed line by line. I can extract all necessary info, unpack, and then using the var set local, I can assign the read value into the new local. Of course, there are more powerful libraries to do this kind of byte string parsing, but I was more interested in the self-documenting aspect, and it, in a certain way, it resembles what the available documentation has. So, testing, there are tests in place, just testing the CPU emulation. There are small programs to test each instruction, making sure the computed values are right, the memory is read and written to the correct addresses, correct values. It was really easy to add testing to the emulator because just by monkey patching or wrapping the already written functions, I could make sure the inputs and outputs was the expected ones. And if I compare the work needed to do this with the work I had to do with the emulator written in C, well, I had to splatter ifdefs all over the place. This was no more than an eye shot to have the tests in place. So, the demo time. Okay. I hope the screen is a little small. I hope it's visible. Okay. Where's my screen? Okay. Wrong desktop. Sorry. Let's go again. Start again. New with just boot the computer. I can stand writing programs. Change the border, print, hello. Hey. That's it. List. So this is an actual game. I can pass this loads one of those snapshots. This is a game from the 80s. Okay, the window and one desktop again. This one has a demo mode. People who write games here don't laugh, please. This was the 80s. You can. Not many colors. So basically, this is just interpreting each instructions. No optimization was made. Just finish the working emulation and that's it. I'm getting around 25 frames per second. I should be getting 50, but since the display code is totally unoptimized, I'm pretty sure I can hit the real-time speed with just using plain Lua. No need for your sheet here. And then that's pretty much it. Where to get this? The code is hosting on GitHub. This is a repository. And this site, there's plenty of software to download and try. Okay, that's it.
might have missed it, but are you controlling the rate in the machine?
Sorry?
Are you controlling how fast the process is running?
It's running as fast as it can.
Okay.
I don't do any timing. If I were emulating sound, which is something I'm currently not doing, I would have to control the frame rate to make it play smooth.
How did you implement the exchange actually?
Exchange all resistance. It's just copying the values from one resistor.
You don't have a flag or something.
No. Just
like
switch.
Yeah.
It's not the emulation of not like electrically activated.
Yeah.
It's more like that way.
Does it run Linux?
Yeah, of course. It should be easier to get this running on Linux than on Windows. I had a lot of time to compile the Lua SDL2.
I
want to
remember
about
the leads.
The leads.
A game.
The...
It's a game.
Most certainly it will. Emulation is here, of course.
Lines. Can't you count lines?
I have no idea. I didn't count how much lines. Mostly since there are a lot of instructions that I haven't written with the template yet, so I did all the dirty work by hand instead of the doing
it. How do you instantiate those generic instructions?
Yeah, it was a slide here. I just assign a function that goes here when I load.
Oh, but you do by hand each one?
There are an array with names, so I just look on them and build in the comments. Just a couple of lines.
So I think you said that sound, and I guess CPU timings are two things that you haven't looked into yet. Are there any other things left to do?
Lots of things to do. Snapshot formats to be parsed. The sound. I can improve the drawing code. I can't resize the screen correctly. And of course, other models. This is the 4810 kilowatt model. There are other models that have 128 kilobytes. And there are Russian clones, and a lot of variations. And as a hobby, I have more things to add to this.